Good afternoon. We have exams for you. Come up afterwards and get them. Is there anything else I was supposed to say? Anything else? No? Am I tearing?
Yes.
Am I crying?
No.
Thank you. All right, today we're going to talk about transformation in oncogenesis. This is one of my favorite lectures. I like them all, of course, but this is one of my favorite because in the end, it all makes sense, as you will see. Oh, I hope you see. Anyway, we're going to talk about viral transformation in oncogenesis. There are many other ways that you can transform and cause tumors. Today is about viruses. So what is transformation? Transformation today refers to altered properties of cells in culture. So they don't have to stick to a plastic surface anymore. They lose their anchorage dependence. They lose contact inhibition. Normally when you grow cells in a culture dish, when they touch each other, they stop growing. Transformation, they don't stop. They keep piling up on top of each other. They can form colonies in agar. So if you suspend them in agar, semi-solid media, they could form colonies. Most cells cannot do that. And they have decreased requirements for growth factors. You need less serum to grow than a non-transformed cell. All this will become perfectly clear to you by the end of this lecture. If not, see me. Okay. All right, so that's transformation. Oncogenesis, we're not going to actually talk very much about oncogenesis today because this is a whole course in itself, which I believe is offered here. This is development of cancer, which is a malignant tumor. That is growth that isn't contained. It outgrows itself, moves into other tissues, disrupts structures, and so forth. Cancer is a genetic disease. And it comprises multiple mutations that affect cell growth, the regulation of cell growth, communication between cells, and so forth. These mutations that cause cancer can be inherited. They can be caused by DNA damage caused by sunlight, carcinogens in the environment, or viruses. And the viral causes we'll talk about today. But again, we're going to mainly focus on transformation, which is the first step towards cancer. So these two processes are really distinct. This is an important point which you should really understand. Transformation is something we talk about concerning cells in culture, whereas oncogenesis is the development of a tumor, and that, of course, just happens in an animal. If you have a transformed cell in culture, it may or may not be oncogenic. If you inject it into an animal, it may or may not form a tumor, depending on how many mutations it has. You need so many mutations to transform a cell, and we'll talk about those today, and then additional mutations to be oncogenic. But when we study transformation of cells by viruses, it gives us really great insight on what it's needed to go along the path of oncogenesis. Okay, so that's the bottom line for today's talk. Viruses can initiate this process. They can transform cells, as you will see today, but they don't cause cancer themselves. They put the cells on the road to cancer, but the additional mutations that have to be sustained are generated in the cell and have nothing to do with the virus. So no virus can do it all. So these are some oncogenic viruses. These are both RNA and DNA viruses that have been associated with cancers, both in people and in other types of animals. We will touch on a few of these today. We'll talk about retroviral cancers. And we will talk about cancers caused by adenoviruses, the papilloma, and the polyoma viruses, because these are historically where we got the information to understand how this works. We're not going to talk about hepatitis C virus and hepatitis B viruses, which are big causes of human cancer. We won't talk about herpes viruses induced cancers. It's just too much for one lecture. Now, in terms of human virus-induced cancers, about 20% of human cancers have a viral factor. And these are the seven viruses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that have been associated with human cancers. Epstein-Barr virus, hepatitis B and C viruses, HTLV-1, the virus we talked about a bit last time, human papillomaviruses, herpes virus 8, Kaposi's sarcoma virus, right, associated with AIDS to cause those sarcomas, and Merkel cell polyoma virus, causing a rare skin tumor, this association just recently discovered. All right, 20% of human cancers are associated with virus infection. They are a major cause of liver and cervical cancer, the Hep B and Hep C, of course, and the papillomaviruses as well. But remember, malignancy isn't needed for any virus to replicate. What happens to lead to a virus-induced cancer is an accident. It's the way the host responds to the infection that causes the cancer. So if there were no virus-induced cancers, the viruses would replicate and spread just as well as they do today. It's an accident. And you will see by the end why it is an accident. But it's not the intent of viruses to cause cancer. It doesn't give them any advantage. Now, this begins in 1909 with the discovery by Peyton Rouse. He was working down at the Rockefeller, and he was studying a tumor of chickens. And this is a sarcoma. You can see it on this hen right here, a solid tumor of connective tissue. And he found that if he ground up these tumors and made a cell-free filtrate, 0.2 micron filters, and injected that into new chickens, they would develop tumors. So 1909, just after viruses had been discovered, so he said, wow, a virus can cause tumors. Cancer can be caused by a viral infection. So our whole story begins there. There's Dr. Rouse. Took people 50 years to accept the idea that a virus could cause cancer. And this, as I said before, the longest incubation period to a Nobel Prize. In 1966, he was finally awarded a Nobel Prize for this work that he'd done in 1909. So the virus he identified is called Rouse sarcoma virus, after him. So he got a Nobel Prize for this discovery, and you will see two other Nobel Prizes were awarded for work on this virus as well. You're trying to remember which ones, right? Don't say it. Okay. All right, now there is a great book about the history of cancer by Siddhartha Mukherjee, who happens to be an oncologist working at the medical center at Columbia. He got the Pulitzer Prize for this book. It's a beautifully written history of cancer. So if you ever want to learn that, this is the book to read. And I want to read you a few passages because they illustrate these early days of Rouse that I want to tell you about. So by the 1950s, cancer researchers were split into three camps. The virologists, led by Rouse, claimed that viruses cause cancer. But of course, no human cancer virus had yet been discovered by that time. Epidemiologists said that chemicals cause cancer. There was plenty of evidence for that. And then other people thought that genes in our own cells mutated and caused cancer. But nobody had good evidence to support these separate theories. So here is Howard Temin here on the upper left and Renato Dulbecco. So in 1951, Temin went to Dulbecco's lab, and he was originally going to study fruit flies. Sorry, he went to Caltech. He was going to study fruit flies, but he got tired of that and found Dulbecco's lab, and Dulbecco was working on Rouse sarcoma virus. Dulbecco just died a few weeks ago. He was 97 years old, still working. So he started studying Rouse, and up until this point, 1951, people were still studying this virus in chickens. They were injecting it into chickens, seeing the tumors, and trying to figure out what was going on. And Temin said, this is ridiculous. We have to do this in cell culture. So a strength in Dulbecco's lab was doing cell culture. In fact, Dulbecco developed a plaque assay. He was really good at growing cells. And this was early days in cell culture. Not many people were good at doing these sorts of things. So what Temin did, and this is all written by Mukherjee, by the way, he took Rouse sarcoma viruses and he added it to a monolayer of chicken cells in a culture dish. So they'd figured out how to grow these cells. And what happened is the cells started to grow uncontrollably, and they formed tiny heaps containing hundreds of cells that Temin called foci. And he said, this is cancer in its essential elemental form, cells growing uncontrollably. All right? Now, we know now this is not cancer. These are transformed cells. But back then, we didn't quite understand the difference. But what he did was amazing, because he made a cell culture assay for this virus. And here's some pictures of avian cells transformed by Rouse. You can see they make different kinds of transformed foci here. They're called fusiform. They're long, spindly cells. And here are the normal cells, uninfected cells in the monolayer. So here's a transformed focus. So you can imagine that you could use this to quantify virus. You could, instead of measuring plaque forming units, you could measure focus forming units. Here are some other kinds of foci. These are round refractile cells as opposed to the spindly ones. So Temin found an assay and he showed these viruses could transform cells, and this transformation was permanent. The cells never got normal again. They grew like crazy. They had all those properties that we talked about in the first slide. And Temin said, you know, this virus has to have modified these cells. Now, in 1951, all we know is that it's an RNA virus. We don't know anything about the Baltimore scheme, right? And he said, this virus has to be making itself a permanent part of the cell. And from that logic, he went on to discover reverse transcriptase in Rouse sarcoma virus here. And he, and along with David Baltimore, discovered it in another virus. They got the second Nobel Prize using Rouse's virus. All right, so that's a really nice cell culture assay. All right, now, at the same time, people started to study DNA viruses that transformed cells. And here are two examples. In 1962, polyoma virus was found to transform cells. This is a little double-stranded DNA virus. You may remember we talked about SV40 polyoma virus. So polyoma is a mouse virus that was found to transform hamster cells. In 1964, mouse cells were found to be transformed by SV40, which is a monkey virus. All right. So remember that. It's the wrong species every time. And the transformation event is rare. So most of the cells don't get transformed. Most of the cells either die or are unaffected. You get some rare cells that have markedly different growth properties. They're transformed. And that's where the name came from. Transformation, they were transformed into something different. Yes?
What do you mean by the wrong species?
So polyoma is a mouse virus. It causes tumors in hamsters, but not in mice. SV40 is a monkey virus. It does not cause tumors in monkeys. Causes tumors in mouse cells. So you will see with all the other viruses we talk about, they don't cause tumors in their host of origin, let's say. And you'll see why that is. So the question now is, how does a virus do this? And I told you how Temin was working along this way by identifying reverse transcriptase, and that was great, but it still didn't answer the question. Here's a more general view of what has to happen to transform a cell. First, you have to lower cytopathic effects. The virus can't kill the cell. Otherwise, they're gone and there's nothing to transform. So you cannot kill the infected cell. That's one requirement. Two, you have to reduce viral replication. And in most cases, the transformed cells, cells transformed by polyoma or SV40, do not produce infectious virus. And finally, the cells have to divide. And part of the property of transformation is to become immortal. So you can imagine the virus has to be suppressed in some way, otherwise the cells wouldn't be able to live forever. Yes?
Why couldn't you have a tumor that was also producing viruses?
Well, you could for some kinds of viruses. So the RNA tumor viruses can in some cases, but it's very rare. The answer is, well, it will become obvious by the end of this lecture. You'll see. If you don't know it, ask me at the end. Okay, so think about these first two conditions. Reduce cytopathic effects, reduce viral replication. Those are hallmarks of persistent infections. Dr. Silverstein told you this a few lectures ago. But these are not persistent infections because of these reasons. The whole genome is never present or rarely present. It's usually pieces of it. Sometimes there's no viral genome in the transformed cells at all. And these observations made early on, people didn't understand this. So the only thing we can say so far is that these are not persistent or latent infections, because in those the genome is present in some form. These infections is either no genome or just pieces of it. And that didn't make any sense to anyone. So what's going on here? So now I want to tell you how we answer this question using studies on both RNA and DNA tumor viruses. So the RNA virus is exemplified by Rouse, and the DNA tumor virus is these small DNA viruses and another one that we'll introduce in a moment. So Rouse's studies began in the 1900s. DNA viruses in the 1920s, and these all came together in the 60s and 70s, along with people who were working on cancer biology, not particularly interested in viruses, but these three lines of studies all converged amazingly, and this leads us to our present theory of cell growth control, which is really the underpinnings of understanding transformation in oncogenesis. All right, so let's go through this and see how this happened. The first question, how does RAUS cause tumors and how does it transform cells in vitro? 60 years it took from the beginning of RAUS's identification of the virus to understanding that. So this story begins actually a year before RAUS. In 1908, two investigators, Ellerman and Bang, had showed that a leukemia in chickens was caused by a filtrable agent. But no one really paid attention to this because leukemia was not considered to be a cancer. All right, Rouse's tumors, his solid sarcomas, were cancers in everyone's view. So that, that's a virus causing cancer. But this leukemia, nobody really understood that as a cancer. It turns out that these leukemias in chickens are caused by avian leukosis virus, ALV. And these viruses are in all chicken flocks throughout the world. You eat a chicken, you go to the market, that chicken may or may not have avian leukosis. It's not going to affect you, but it was infected. Most chickens in the world are infected within a few months of hatching. And if they do develop leukemia, they get it within about 14 weeks or so. It occurs very sporadically. About 3% of the flock will get leukemia. The rest of the birds have a viremia. They make an immune response, and then they're fine. So the chickens you buy don't have virus in them anymore because they've cleared it. And the ones with leukemia have died, so they never go to market. This is a very slow infection. It's a very slow disease. It's not an acute infection at all. All right, so that is 1908. That's our understanding of this chicken virus. Now, as these birds get older, these birds who survived the initial infection with avian leukosis virus, they start to develop spontaneously various kinds of tumors, including sarcomas, the tumor that Raus studied. And if you take the virus from those sarcomas, remember Raus did that, you filter it, it will cause sarcomas. It doesn't cause leukemia. It's a different virus from the one that the chicken started its life from. All right? Now, Raus isolated the virus that causes a sarcoma, Raus sarcoma virus, and this grew very well. But subsequently, he and many others tried to isolate additional sarcoma-causing viruses, but it turned out that most of them were defective. They can't grow on their own. They're missing parts of their genome. All right? So, in fact, if you wanted to grow these other viruses, these non-Raus viruses, you could only grow them if you mix them with the original avian leukosis virus, which provided the missing functions. We call that a helper virus. All right, so what does this mean? What is the relationship of Raus to these avian leukosis viruses? So Raus, remember, replicates well and it transforms, and all the other isolates that everyone else isolated that causes chicken tumors didn't replicate very well. So it turns out that Raus was really lucky, as you will see. How does Raus cause tumors, but not ALV? ALV, remember, causes leukemia in 3% of chicken. So the key finding here, made many years after Raus, is that his virus and all the others that cause cancers in chickens, not leukosis virus, but the ones that cause solid tissue tumors, these are recombinants. They are viral recombinants. These viruses have replaced a part of the avian leukosis virus genome with a piece of cellular DNA. And this is not just any random DNA, but it's a very specific gene. And these were eventually called oncogenes. Now, in 1976, Michael Bishop and Harold Varmus identified the oncogene in Raus's virus that was picked up by Raus's virus that allows it to cause sarcomas. And they called it V-Sarc, in honor of the sarcoma. And for that, they got a Nobel Prize in 1989. So that's the third Raus-related Nobel Prize. So these viruses pick up, not random, but specific cellular genes that give them their properties. And in this case, the property of causing a sarcoma. So an important insight is that the chickens come down with a variety of tumors. Remember, in all chicken flocks, you have ALV circulating. As they age, they develop different kinds of solid tumors after the leukemia is gone. And if you take a virus from each of these tumors, you have 100 different chickens with different tumors, you take viruses out of them, they're all derived from ALV, but they all have a different cellular gene incorporated into them. Now, Ross was lucky because his virus was not defective. It picked up a cellular gene, but it didn't lose any viral sequence, so it was still replication competent. Okay, but all the other isolates after Ross were all defective. How lucky could he be? Right? So every subsequent isolate has a different piece of host DNA, and none of them had the SARC gene. And each of those genes encode an oncogene. An oncogene, we will define that in a moment, but it's the gene in the virus that allows it to cause tumors. Each isolate had a different oncogene, and this revealed many new cellular genes that could transform cells. It was a veritable gold mine for molecular oncology. So here are just some of these viruses. So on the left, these are proviral sequences. Remember, this is this the DNA that's inserted into the cell. These are retroviruses. Here is avian leukosis virus, the precursor of Rouse's virus. You know, it's got the two LTRs, a GAG, a pollen, an envelope gene. You infect cells with this virus, it replicates, it makes particles, they're infectious. Rouse's virus picked up a cellular gene, shown here in red, called SARC. But it didn't lose any viral sequences. So Rouse's virus was replication competent. And as I say, every other virus isolated from a bird tumor in subsequent years, all kinds of tumors here, different sarcomas, myeloblastosis, erythroblastosis, these all picked up different oncogenes, FIPS, MIB, ETS, MIC, YES, JUN. And at the same time, the virus lost sequence so that it was no longer able to replicate. So these are defective viruses, and they need a helper virus, the helper being ALS, in order to grow them. So again, if Rouse had gotten one of these, he never would have figured out what was going on, not for a long time. So these are avian transducing retroviruses. We call them that because they pick up a cellular gene, and they bring it into other cells and transform them. On the right, the same thing happens with retroviruses from mice. Here is a mouse retrovirus called murine leukemia virus, the same structure as Rouse, avian leukosis virus, GAG polom with the two LTRs. And you can isolate from mouse tumors that arise in mice these transducing retroviruses, which have picked up various mouse genes. And these, again, are oncogenes that disrupt, for the most part, these viruses, make them replication defective. Okay, so that's why Rouse was lucky. And this is why his and all the other viruses are able to transform cells. So you may be, so let me just explain a little bit what I mean by defective versus non-defective before we move on. So a defective virus is missing sequence. So if you take its genome and put it in a cell, it can't replicate. It can't make particles. It needs a helper virus that you would co-infect with it in order to provide the missing sequences. And so Rouse is not defective, but all those other bird transforming viruses are, and you need to use avian leukosis as a helper to get them to grow. Yes?
Does that mean that Rouse is one of those tumors that can produce viruses?
It could, yes. So a Rouse tumor could, in theory, produce virus, but the other ones could not because they're defective. So that's part of the answer to your question, right? So typically the envelope proteins are deleted, so if you don't have a glycoprotein in the particle, you can't replicate. That's why they are defective. And again, you lose these viral genes during the process of capturing an oncogene from the cell. Okay, everyone has that? All right, so how do you get this oncogene from the cell? I don't want to go into it in too much detail because we don't really know the mechanism, but this is a hypothetical way. You know that retroviruses integrate into the host cell genome, a DNA copy of their genome. That integration is more or less randomly. So at some point, the virus is going to integrate next to an oncogene. That is a cell gene that's important for regulating cell growth. We'll talk about that in a moment. So here we have a proviral DNA integrated next to an oncogene. Now, most of the time, the viral mRNA produced from this provirus initiates and terminates within the LTRs. But sometimes the termination isn't precise and you get longer transcripts that will then include some of the oncogene or all of the oncogene sequence. All right? So this is aberrant transcription termination. The idea is then you can package this into a virus particle. So now you would have an mRNA where you're missing some viral sequence and it's replaced with the oncogene sequence. And remember, the viral particles incorporate two RNAs. So if one of these RNAs is the wild type complete RNA, during reverse transcription, you can construct a complete genome, including both viral sequence and oncogene sequence. And so now that's what we have here. We have a provirus with a cellular oncogene that's been incorporated into it. So that's the idea of how these viruses pick up these oncogenes. They integrate next to them and then they become transcribed. These are typically not precise copies. They're either mutated or they're overexpressed. So when the viruses pick up these oncogenes from the cell, they can be altered in the process of reverse transcription and replication, which is mutagenic, and that alteration can cause these oncogenes to have growth-promoting properties. But not every oncogene is mutated. Sometimes they are the same gene as is in the cell, but they are now overexpressed in the retroviral genome. Whereas in the cell, their expression was tightly regulated. In the retroviral genome, they're overexpressed. All right, so they are not, that's what I mean by they are not precise copies of host genes. They are either mutated or overexpressed. So the cellular versions of these genes we call proto-oncogenes. And as you'll see in a moment, these genes control the cell cycle. They regulate when cells are going to divide. So you can start to imagine how they can transform cells. If you express them at the wrong time, or if they are mutated so that are active all the time, the cell then will grow all the time when these oncogenes are present in them. So proto-oncogene is the name of the gene in the cell before the virus picks it up. They're in all cells, and they're important for regulating cell growth, and we'll see how in just a moment. So they're very highly regulated because if they get dysregulated in cells, the cells will be transformed. We know over 60 so far, all pretty much discovered by virtue of being picked up in retroviruses, transforming retroviruses. So the cellular genes, again, they're called proto-oncogenes. The abbreviations are little c in front of the name with the name of the protein. So c-MYC, c-MOS, c-RAS would be the cellular gene that was picked up in, SARC would be the cellular gene that would be picked up in Rouse sarcoma virus. Now, when a virus picks up these cellular genes, we now put a little V in front of it, V-ONC, V-MYC, V-MOS, V-RAS, V-SARC. So that's the terminology. So what do these do? What do these oncogenes do? There are five major classes that have been discovered by studying transforming retroviruses. So first we have genes that encode for growth factors. Proteins that bind to receptors on the cell surface and stimulate cell proliferation. We have growth factor receptors. Some retroviruses pick up these. These are important, again, for making cells go through the cell cycle. We have signal transduction proteins. These are the proteins that transfer the signal from the growth factor receptor on the cell surface to the nucleus. We have nuclear transcription factors that are part of this pathway. And finally, tumor suppressor genes. These are negative regulators of cell growth. These are not picked up by retroviruses. We will talk about these later on in terms of DNA tumor viruses. All right, so these are the five classes of proto-oncogenes, and these four are typically picked up in retroviruses, and when expressed, overexpressed, or when mutated, cause transformation. They cause cells to divide uncontrollably. So here's a picture of such a growth pathway and how these oncogenes work. So the gene is called an oncogene. The encoded protein is an oncoprotein. So we have the four classes of proto-oncogenes. We have growth factors. So the genes encoding the actual growth factor can be picked up by a retrovirus. Of course, when a growth factor binds a receptor, it starts a signaling pathway through a variety of kinases, which ends up activating transcription factors in the nucleus, you then make proteins that you need to push the cell cycle forward, to let the cell divide. So this is the mitogenic stimulation pathway for the cell cycle. So at each of these steps, growth factors, receptors, protein kinases, cytoplasmic kinases, nuclear oncogenes, all of these are proto-oncogenes. These can be picked up by retroviruses, and if abnormally expressed or mutated, will cause cellular transformation. So remember, the original phenotype in cells, transformation, uncontrolled growth, change of cell shape, and loss of adhesion. When you overexpress any of these components in this pathway, that's the phenotype you get. So now we understand how these viruses transform cells. They pick up members of this mitogenic pathway. So normally these genes are under strict control. You can't have cells dividing all the time. In fact, most of our cells are quiescent and only divide in specific conditions. These are activated when they're picked up by retroviruses. Now the retroviruses, there are two ways that we activate these genes, these oncogenes, by mutations. So you can take a protein kinase that's part of the signal transduction pathway. It sustains a mutation so that it's always activated. So that will always lead to transcription, and the cell will divide uncontrollably. So that is what I mean by mutations in the normal gene. So this mutation is now present in the gene that's in the retrovirus. Or you can have loss of controlled expression. So in the host, all of these components of that mitogenic pathway are tightly controlled. But in the retrovirus, they're expressed all the time. So the retrovirus infects the cell, and it starts expressing a growth factor or a growth factor receptor or a nuclear transcription factor, and this just makes the cells divide incessantly. There's no longer any growth control, and that's an essential part of transformation. So these are dominant kinds of mutations. Right? There's there is one kind of oncogene where the mutations are receptor, and that is in the tumor suppressor genes. These are negative regulators of the cell cycle. So far, the oncogenes we've talked about, these growth factor components, these are positive regulators. When they're present, they drive cells to replicate. The tumor suppressor genes are negative regulators. They stop cell division. And when they're absent, you get transformation. And we'll see how they work in a moment. So we've been talking about the cell cycle for a bit. So let's look at the diagram of the cell cycle, which I'm sure all of you have seen. As a cell divides, it goes through a mitosis phase, of course, which is a major checkpoint, a pause, and then the synthesis phase, and finally another pause before undergoing mitosis. And the proto-oncogenes we have talked about so far all act here at this point. There are two important checkpoints in the cell cycle. There's a go or not go checkpoint right here before mitosis. And if there are growth factors present, the cell will proceed through mitosis because of the signaling pathways that I've just told you about. And in fact, all of our understanding, or a great deal of our understanding of how growth factors lead to cells going through mitosis, has come by studying these transforming retroviruses, because they have picked up all the components of that pathway. All right, so those are the dominant oncogenes. There's another important checkpoint here before the cells start making DNA, the S phase. There is a checkpoint, because if all is not right, the cells will not move ahead to that point, because the tumor suppressor genes will stop the cell cycle at that point. And we'll talk about how that works in a moment. These, in fact, were discovered by studying DNA tumor viruses. So this is such a beautiful coming together of information. You have our understanding of how this cell cycle is controlled by studies on RNA tumor viruses and DNA tumor viruses. Okay, so retroviruses, talked about so far, transform cells in three ways. So they can make rapid tumors, like Rouse sarcoma virus. It takes about 2 weeks after injection. And that's because these viruses carry an activated oncogene, like the SARC gene. The virus makes the protein. It starts driving the cells through the cell cycle. It acts at the very top, drives the cells through mitosis. The cells just keep dividing. They keep dividing, they're transformed. That's part of the transformed phenotype. There are intermediate speed of tumor formation, like avian leukosis viruses. These don't have a dominant V-onc in them. There's no cellular oncogene. What these viruses do, they integrate next to an oncogene, and then transcription from the LTR of the provirus causes unregulated production of the oncoprotein. Okay? So the virus doesn't carry an oncogene. It takes a bit longer for the tumors to form because the virus has to integrate and then you have to produce the oncogene mRNA. And then there are very, very slow kinetics of tumor formation, like HTLV-1. HTLVs take years to make tumors. These have no oncogenes in them, and they don't integrate next to oncogenes either. What they do is they make regulatory proteins, transcriptional activators that they need for the production of their own mRNAs, and these activate cellular genes, and among them are oncogenes, and eventually that leads to transformation. All right, so that you can see there are three ways that you can transform cells. You can carry an oncogene, you can integrate next to it, or you can transactivate an oncogene with transcription factors. So that leads to the different kinds of transforming retroviruses that exist. This is sort of a repetition of what I've just told you. Now we're looking at in terms of the kind of retrovirus. They're transducing retroviruses. Again, they pick up a cellular oncogene. There are cis-acting retroviruses that integrate next to an oncogene and activate its transcription in an uncontrolled fashion. And then there are transacting retroviruses, like HTLV-1. They don't integrate next to an oncogene. They don't carry one. They make transacting transcription factors that activate cellular growth genes. So, for example, IL-2 is activated in HTLV-1 infected cells, and that pushes the cells to divide uncontrollably. So the common theme here, the transformation phenotype is caused by unregulated cell division. And that in turn is caused by producing the components of that mitogenic pathway, the growth factors, the receptors, etc., by producing them in an unregulated manner. And that's what the retroviruses do. So here's a cartoon that will emphasize all of this once more, but helps to clarify it. The three different kinds of transforming retroviruses. We have the transducing retroviruses. They carry the oncogene in them, in their genome, like Rous sarcoma virus. The cis-activating retroviruses, which do not integrate a oncogene into their genome, but rather they integrate next to a cellular oncogene, and the transcription from the right-hand LTR then makes uncontrolled mRNA encoding this oncogene. And finally, we have the long-term tumor inducers like HTLV-1, the transactivators. So here in this genome, they make a protein called X, which is a transactivator. It's a transcriptional transactivator, which is needed for its own gene expression, but this transactivator will also cause the unregulated production of certain cellular mRNAs, among them encoding gene products that push the cells to divide incessantly. And that's what leads to transformation. So this is the first step to forming a tumor. You transform cells, they replicate uncontrollably. When cells divide uncontrollably without regulation, they begin to accumulate mutations. And if you have enough mutations in the right genes, then you can cause cancer. Then those transformed cells will cause a cancer. So the transforming retroviruses, as you can see, they cause transformation as a byproduct of their life cycle. Most of them are defective. There's not even any virus replication involved. So this has nothing to do with retroviral growth whatsoever. It is completely an accident because retroviruses are insertional mutagens. So this is a byproduct of that lifestyle that these viruses integrate into the host cell. The consequences of that is that sometimes you're going to cause problems. You're going to pull out the wrong cellular gene or you're going to integrate next to it. There's no requirement for transformation or oncogenesis in the life cycle of these viruses. As I said before, if this never happened, these viruses would be fine. It's an accident. Okay. So that is the information we learned from studying Rous. So now we have this amazing understanding of how these cellular pathways regulate cell division, that whole mitogenic pathway was sorted out because of these oncogenes that were identified at every step of the pathway. Amazing way that these viruses have taught us about cell growth. Let's go over here now on the right and see how studying DNA tumor viruses adds to this story. And it is all about transformation again, but it's a totally different story. So here, the first oncogenic DNA virus was papillomaviruses that cause warts in rabbits. This is by Richard Shope in 1933. So I don't know if you've ever seen a rabbit with these types of warts, but this virus infects them in nature. They grow these long proliferations on their lips and also other parts of their head. And have you ever heard of the term a jackalope? No? Jackalope? So a jackalope is a mythical creature, a jackrabbit with the antlers of an antelope. It's mythical because what it is people see these animals with papillomas and they think it's something unusual. But all they are rabbits with this virus. So 1933. In 1953, Ludwig Gross discovered polyomaviruses. These are viruses of mice, small double-stranded DNA containing viruses. We've talked about related viruses here in this course in terms of DNA replication and transcription. These viruses will cause tumors under certain conditions, but not in mice, which is the natural host. In fact, if you go out and trap wild mice, you will find plenty of polyomaviruses, and these mice don't have tumors ever, not at least caused by these viruses. But they will make tumors in other animals, like hamsters, rats, and rabbits. Not in mice, though, which is the normal host. Another virus discovered, which is important to this story, SV40. We've talked about this virus in this course. This was discovered actually because it was a contaminant of the polio vaccine. So the polio vaccine is still grown in monkey kidney cells. Yes?
So when a virus causes a tumor in a different species,
right,
is that infectious in that species, or is that if there's like...
This is a great question. We're going to get to this. Can you wait?
Yeah,
absolutely. This is exactly what we're going to do. It's important, actually, that it's the wrong species. So the polio vaccines are grown in monkey kidneys. You get a monkey, and you take out the kidneys, you chop them up, and you put it in cell culture, and you grow virus polio in it. Well, in 1962, Hilleman and Eddy found a contaminant, which they called SV40, simian virus number 40, and it was in the polio vaccine. And many million Americans got this virus before we knew to stop to look for it in the monkey kidney cells. The natural host of this virus is monkey. It doesn't cause tumors in monkeys, either in the wild or in the lab. It doesn't seem to cause tumors in people either. These people were followed for many years who were injected with this virus, and they seem to be fine. But it will transform other cell types. So even though it's called a DNA tumor virus, in its natural host, it doesn't cause tumors. So SV40 and mouse polyomavirus, these are the two viruses we're going to follow a little bit here. And this is just a chart which shows you what these do in different species. So the species of origin of SV40 is the monkey. These animals and cells derived from them are permissive. The virus will grow. These are actually all susceptible to these viruses. They have receptors. In addition, the monkey is permissive, and the mouse is permissive for mouse polyomavirus. So these viruses replicate in these cells, and they kill them. And so there's no opportunity for transformation. They just kill the cells. Some of these combinations are non-permissive, so SV40 in mouse cells, non-permissive, doesn't even replicate. Mouse polyomavirus in monkeys, non-permissive. But look, there are four situations where the interaction is semi-permissive. So SV40 in hamster or rat cells, or mouse polyomavirus in hamster or rat cells. It's semi-permissive. That means only early proteins are expressed. There are no virions, no infectious virus particles produced. Right. So what you see is that tumors are only occurring in semi-permissive species. All right? not the permissive, not the non-permissive, only in the semi-permissive species. In addition, you need a lot of virus to do this. If you take a plate of hamster cells and you infect with SV40, you need to put a lot of virus on those cells to see a focus or a few foci of transformed cells. So it's not very efficient. All right, so remember, different species, inefficient transformation. So it's a rare event, which I've already told you. You infect a dish with a lot of virus, you only get one transformed cell. It's not a normal part of the replication cycle, because remember, these are non-permissive cells which never complete the replication cycle. So why is it rare, and does this have anything to do with making tumors in an animal? All right, so I'm talking about two things. I'm talking about transformation in cells by these viruses and causing tumors in animals. So we know that in semi-permissive conditions, that is combinations of virus and host cell that are semi-permissive, that's where we see cell transformation. And in those species, we get tumors as well. So what's the relationship? All right, before we talk about that, I want to tell you about one or two more transforming DNA viruses. One is adenovirus. We've talked about these in this course. These are these rather large DNA viruses with the spikes coming out of the fivefold axes. There are many human serotypes. None of them cause tumors in people. So they cause tumors in hamsters. Some of the serotypes cause tumors in hamsters, but not all of them. Again, these viruses will transform cultured cells from these species, and they cause tumors in those animals, but they're both pretty rare. And it's the same for polyomaviruses and papillomavirus. So you need a lot of virus to make just one focus of transformed cells. So transformation is rare. Tumor formation only occurs in the wrong species. All right, so now we would like to know, how do these viruses do this? How do they transform and how do they cause tumors? So we've already talked about how retroviruses transform cells. They pick up components of the mitogenic stimulatory pathway. So how do the DNA tumor viruses do it? Is it the same or is it different? And the key here are the T antigens, the tumor antigens. We've talked about these in terms of DNA synthesis of transcription. T antigens in general, or tumor antigens, are proteins that are newly synthesized in a tumor in a host. And if that tumor is made by a virus, these are typically viral proteins. So people began to find that tumors caused by these DNA viruses in animals had a protein in them, and that turned out to be the T antigen, which was a viral protein. The interesting thing about this is that these rare transformed cells, no matter where you made them in, they always had the same T antigen in them, the same viral T antigen. And on top of that, most of the viral DNA, whether it be SV40 or papillomavirus or adenovirus, is missing from the transformed cell. So remember, you take a plate of hamster cells, you infect with a lot of SV40, you get a few rare foci. Those are all missing most of the genome, but they're all making a T antigen, which is the same protein. Okay? So this is very different from retrovirus transformation. It seems to be that this T antigen is very important. Now, in fact, I've told you that most of the viral DNA is missing from these transformed cells. Again, when you use DNA tumor viruses. But there is something always in common. There's always a piece of viral DNA left, and that is the DNA that encodes the T antigen. So it seems like having T antigen is important for transformation. So viral T antigens are made in transformed cells. And you remember we have discussed these before, large and small T for SV40, polyoma, large, middle, and small T. And these are different proteins with no homology. So again, these are the T antigens that you find in transformed cells. For the papillomaviruses, there are three T antigens. They're called E5, E6, and E7. They're encoded by those genes. Adenoviruses also have T antigens. They're called E1A and E1B. So for the rest of today, I'm going to just call them all T antigens. Okay? But remember that they are very different here. These papilloma and adenoproteins have no homology among them. The only thing in common is that they're all present in cells transformed by these viruses. So what do they do? These T antigens seem to be important for transformation. What are they doing? So you remember that These T antigens are essential genes. They're needed for transcription of the viral DNA. They're needed for viral DNA synthesis. And as I said, they're the only DNA sequences that are retained in transformed cells. Finally, someone showed that if you took the gene for these T antigens and put it in a plasmid and put it into cells, that was enough to transform the cell. So you didn't even need the virus. You didn't need virus, any aspect of virus infection. So for DNA tumor viruses, transformation is achieved simply by expressing the T antigen, whatever one, for the T of polyoma, the E1A or E1B of adenovirus, the E5, E6 proteins of papillomas, that's enough to transform cultured cells. So now remember, the T antigens are needed for viral replication, and they are needed to alone can transform cells. We've just discussed that. Now, why does SV40 and these other viruses require T antigen? Just to refresh you from a long time ago, SV40 doesn't encode a DNA polymerase. It depends on that of the host cell. And the T antigen helps recruit the polymerase to the origin of replication. Furthermore, SV40 infection kicks the cells into S phase. It wants the cells to be making DNA, right? That's what happens in S phase, because it wants the active DNA polymerase to replicate its own genome. So SV40 doesn't want a cell to be quiescent. It wants it replicating. And so that's perfect. It can take this DNA replication machinery, and it interacts with T antigen, will replicate the viral DNA. So that's why T antigen is important. We've known that already, and that's why it's also important to kick the cells into the S phase of the cycle. Now, let's try and bring all of this together. There were three discoveries made that really unify everything we've been talking about in terms of DNA tumor viruses. First, it was found that a cellular protein of about 53 kilodaltons was bound to SV40 T antigen. This is called P53. Second, it was found that transcription of the adeno early genes, in particular the E2 cluster, needed a cellular transcription factor called E2F. This is actually a family of proteins, but they're transcription factors. Adenovirus needs these to transcribe certain of its early genes. So that's fact number two. Fact number three, E2F, so the transcription factor that adenovirus needs in the cell, is bound to a cellular protein called RB. This stands for retinoblastoma. All right. All three of these proteins, P53, RB, and E2F, are crucial for regulating the cell cycle. So sounds familiar, right? The oncogenes of retroviruses were all involved in cell cycle regulation. Same thing for these DNA tumor viruses. So let's see how that happens. Here's the cell cycle again. So we have mitosis at the top here, and here are the different parts of mitosis. Of course, it's when the cells are splitting apart. After that, it goes through a pause, and then we'll move into the S phase. So there is a restriction point before the S phase, which is regulated, as we said before. Then you go into S phase, where the DNA is duplicated, and then finally, after another gap, you have mitosis again. So two important checkpoints here at M and here at the entry to S. This is controlled by growth factor pathways. This, is you will see, is controlled by these retinoblastoma proteins. So here's the link between these three proteins and the cell cycle. RB and P53 are negative regulators. They are tumor suppressors. So they regulate this checkpoint from G1 into S. So they stop cells from moving into the S phase if conditions aren't right. So if there aren't enough nutrients in the medium, this can be sensed, and RB and P53 will sense that, and they will stop the cell cycle before S continues. There's no point in making DNA if there's not enough growth factors to make two new cells. You don't want to replicate your genome. So these are negative regulators of the cell cycle. They're the opposite of the oncogenes from the RNA tumor viruses, which push the cell cycle forward. They're positive regulators. That's why we call these tumor suppressor genes. They antagonize the cell cycle and regulate growth. So to expand upon what I've just told you, if if there are enough growth factors in the media to replicate the cell, you will proceed through mitosis, and at the same time you will eventually proceed through the S phase. And again, the proteins that regulate the proceeding through M are the growth factor pathways initiated by the soluble growth factors, and all the components of those pathways are picked up as oncogenes by retroviruses or activated them. Now, if conditions are not right, even after going through mitosis, the cell will stop right here. So as I said, you may have signals to proceed through mitosis, but if there aren't sufficient nutrients, you won't make DNA for the next round of division. And this checkpoint is regulated by this RB protein. Now, RB was originally discovered because it's mutated in certain kinds of retinal tumors called retinoblastoma. And it's mutated, it's lost its function, and it can no longer regulate the progression through S. So that's why this a loss of this protein leads to these tumors. But it turns out that this is a very important regulator in all cell types, not just in retinal cells, and it regulates the transition into the S phase. So how does that work? So if you have nutrients in the cell medium, they will bind growth factor receptors. So here's a growth factor shown as a little yellow ball here. That binding initiates a signal transduction cascade, which ends up in causing a series of phosphorylation events. There are protein kinases, there are transcription factors that go in the nucleus, and all of those are components of, all of those are proto-oncogenes, which are picked up by retroviruses. Eventually, what happens is you get the activation of a protein kinase which phosphorylates the RB protein, and this separates it from E2F. So remember, E2F was discovered to bind RB. E2F is needed for adenovirus transcription, but in an uninfected cell it has a function, and E2F is normally activating genes that are needed for progression through the S phase. So when you have plenty of nutrients, you have signaling, which leads to phosphorylation of RB, separates it from E2F. E2F can then go and bind all of its gene targets and turns on genes that are needed to start S phase. All right, so that's the connection between growth factors in the medium and the retinoblastoma protein. So again, the phosphorylation of RB separates it from E2F. So when RB is bound to E2F, E2F can't bind its targets, the genes aren't transcribed, and that keeps the cell from going into S because the E2F-dependent genes are needed to proceed into the S phase. Okay. Now, viruses, as you know, need to get cells into S. They want active DNA replication in the cell. They don't want anything to do with this RB protein regulating that. Okay. So T antigen, in fact, kicks the cells into S phase. And this happens when T antigens bind to RB. So remember, RB is bound to E2F. T antigen comes along. It's made by a virus. T antigen binds RB. It separates it from E2F. Now E2F can go on and activate all the genes that are needed for proceeding through the S phase. All right, so that's how these viruses kick the cells into the S phase. They make T antigens which bind RB, and that separates it from E2F, and E2F is essential for the transcription of genes that are needed to go through the S phase. So it's very clever, because the virus wants the cell to be in S because it wants to use the DNA polymerase. So this is a too complex illustration, but I want to use it just to show you one thing. So here is E2F bound to RB. So this, in this form, E2F is inactive. It can't act as a transcription factor. When the viruses come in and make their T antigens, can be large T, it can be E7, it can be E1A, it doesn't matter. These T antigens will bind RB, release E2F. The E2F, which is now here, this pink guy, can then go and activate the transcription of genes that are needed to push the cell through S. So that's how these viruses activate the cell so that they can get access to their DNA synthetic machinery, by interfering with this checkpoint this RB checkpoint that keeps cells from going into S when conditions aren't right. The virus doesn't care about conditions. It wants the DNA replication to go on, so it doesn't care if there are growth factors in the medium, which is normally what RB would respond to. The virus simply separates RB from E2F, and then mitosis occurs. Okay, so that's RB. What about P53? There's one more thing in this story, and that's P53. So we've talked about how RB controls entry into S, right, through its binding to E2F. P53 also controls the movement into S because it will stop cells from going to that point if it detects damaged DNA or unscheduled DNA, i.e. viral DNA synthesis. So P53 is able to do this. We don't have time to talk about how. It can sense damaged DNA, and it can sense when some other DNA other than the cell DNA is replicating. And the idea is that, of course, if the DNA is damaged, you don't want to replicate it. It will wait till it's repaired. There are repair pathways that then kick in, fix the DNA, and then P53 says, okay, you can go ahead. So P53 is a gatekeeper of the cell cycle. It is actually a transcription factor itself. It can activate the transcription of genes, but it's also a sensor of DNA damage, and it also can recognize viral DNA as abnormal. So what happens if E2 is free? That is, it's not bound to RB. So this is a condition where there are plenty of growth factors around, say. It will cooperate with P53 if P53 detects DNA damage or unscheduled DNA synthesis, and P53 turns on the apoptotic pathways. They say, we're going to kill this cell because things aren't right, the DNA is damaged, and the cell dies. So this is a defense against DNA virus infection. So many, as I've told you, these DNA tumor viruses free up E2F from RB. So if P53 detects that and it detects damaged DNA or unscheduled DNA, which is the case for viral DNA, it will send the cells into apoptosis. So this is another reason why many of these DNA viruses encode inhibitors of apoptosis to counter this activity. Okay, so that is the link between what the virus normally has to do and the transformation by these viruses. The T antigen counter RB. They kick the cells into S phase. In addition, the T antigens have another function. They block P53 function. There are a variety of ways of doing this, which we won't go into. There's some degradation ways and other ways, but basically the T antigens also inactivate P53 because P53 can send the cells into apoptosis, and viruses don't want that to happen. All right. So the viruses want to do this because, again, they want active DNA replication machinery. They don't do it to transform the cells. Most of the time, what this does is makes a very lytic replication cycle. The cell's dead, and that's the end of it. New viruses are produced. But in rare events, in the wrong host, under certain conditions, which we will talk about, the cells don't die, and they end up being transformed because these inhibitory activities just make the cells divide forever and ever. It transforms them. All right, so two more mysteries. Why are all the viral genes not there? Why is just T antigen gene present? And why is transformation so inefficient? It's inefficient because you need two low probability events to happen. First, you have to make sure the late genes are not expressed. These are typically the ones that kill the cell and make new virions. So you have to stop that. You either have to delete them, a rare spontaneous deletion, or infect semi-permissive cells where late gene expression is blocked. Remember in the chart of permissivity, I said some of these cells are semi-permissive. They don't enter into late gene synthesis. So that avoids, in those situations, whatever the block is in those cells, that avoids killing those cells. All right, so that's how you avoid getting late genes expressed, a random deletion that takes away the late genes, or you infect a semi-permissive cell. So a semi-permissive cell is typically a different species. The virus doesn't replicate its late genes, so the propensity for transformation is greater. The other thing that has to happen, which is very rare, is that you have to get T antigen in every cell. You're not going to get a focus of transformed cells unless T antigen is in every one of them, because T antigen will make them divide incessantly, and that's what transformation is. So how does that happen? Well, you can integrate the viral DNA encoding T antigen into the host cell. So when a virus infects a cell, say it's a semi-permissive cell, there's no late gene expression. There's very little, if any, DNA synthesis. The DNA may get broken up, but randomly a piece of DNA encoding T antigen could integrate. And if that produces T antigen protein, then those cells will keep dividing. Because remember, the T antigen is antagonizing RB and P53, which regulate whether the cells go into the S phase. So you can see it's an accident. It is a total accident. This transformation of cells by these DNA tumor viruses is an accident that's derived from the way these viruses have to activate the cell cycle. So we say they're abnormal epigenetic processes. They're not required for a normal life cycle. In fact, they happen typically in non-permissive cells where there is no production of infectious virus. So let's review these steps one more time for these DNA tumor viruses. So the DNA tumor viruses have to interfere with the cell. They have to push it into S phase. This is not the case for RNA tumor viruses. They have to integrate, which is why they can cause tumors sometimes. The DNA tumor viruses have to kick the cells into S. They have to do that because they need the machinery to replicate their DNA. They turn on the cell cycle by inhibiting P53 and RB by this T antigen. And of course, they also block apoptosis. So the reason they do that is to kickstart their DNA replication. But under the right conditions, when the cell is not permissive or semi-permissive, when the DNA is broken up and the T antigen is integrated, the cells are transformed. They don't make viruses. They don't die. They replicate forever. That is what a transformed cell is. It just continues to divide. In culture, we see them as those foci. Eventually, as those cells divide, there's no more P53 checking for damaged DNA. You will accumulate mutations. And eventually, you will have a mutation in enough genes such that if those transformed cells were present in an animal, they would cause a tumor. All right. So in this talk, we've just dealt with transformation by viruses. But the next step, the oncogenesis step, directly as a result of these cells continuing to replicate without having P53 around to make sure the DNA isn't damaged. And so that is why the viruses can do this. They can transform cells very, very efficiently, and eventually those transformed cells cause tumors. So did I answer your question? And in your question about making virions, I answered as well. Any other? Okay.